Yo, what's up, 910 podcast? Yo. Episode number 30-something with KDB.
Hey.
Hey.
It's good to be here.
The non-910er.
Yeah.
Representing 11-12.
Yeah.
All of our sophomores are going to be in 11-12 like...
So soon.
Any minute.
I'm so, excited. Close. They're awesome.
Yeah, they are awesome. We got a good sophomore class right now. They're a lot of fun. We just did game show gala, and our sophomore girls kind of dominated.
And they got that Chick-fil-A.
They did get the Chick-fil-A. Chick-fil-A!
Did they eat them all the nuggets?
They did.
Good.
They crushed a serious amount of nuggets. I was very proud of them. Mm-hmm. But Katie, you are one of the better question askers I've ever been around.
And I have a question for you.
Oh, you're going to start with a question for me?
Yes.
Wow. Okay. How the turntables have turned,
Michael Scott.
Turned.
Okay. What is the best... You've been a lot of places. You've traveled quite a lot. What is the best trip you've ever been on? Why was it the best? Who was there? Where were you? What were you doing? I want details. Man. And I also would love the reverse.
The worst.
Of the worst. But maybe not like who was there because, you know.
Okay. Dang. Okay. Well, that right away, there's three trips popped up in my head.
Okay.
Well, really four trips. It's way too hard for me because experiences are so different. So like the first one that popped in my head was my honeymoon. Paige and I, we spent a week down in Cabo for our wedding.
Yeah.
And then went immediately from Cabo to Bali.
Which is so you guys to have like so a destination wedding. And
yeah.
Then,
it was freaking awesome.
Yeah.
And we spent 2 weeks in Bali and it was just the best. Like Bali's nuts. It's Australia's Hawaii. So like all the Australians vacation in Bali. That's kind of like the thing. So it's very westernized, but it's still Southeast Asia. So you feel safe, but it's dirt cheap. Mm. Like we stayed in like 4-bedroom villas with its own chef and
like
infinity pool like $70 a night.
Oh my gosh.
It's just nuts. You're like,
dang.
This isn't real. Yeah. I mean, it takes forever to get there. I think it was like literally like a 20 hours worth of flying, which was
that's
brutal. But once you're there, I mean, we just rode a scooter everywhere and it was so cheap. Like, I think the most expensive meal we had when we were in Bali, we went to this restaurant called Bridges in Ubud, which was like in the jungle. Mm-hmm. So we spent most of the time on the coast and then we spent like 3 or 4 nights in the jungle in Bali, which is where all the like, if you've ever seen like an Instagram influencer photo, like standing behind a waterfall, like that's Ubud most of the time. Mm-hmm. And in Bali, I'm not talking about like any influencer photo ever, but like in Bali specifically. Yeah. And so we went to this restaurant called Bridges and we had a 7-course meal.
Oh my gosh.
And everybody was like all the waiters, chef, everyone's wearing like all white, like head to toe.
Wow.
And it's like the, like they come out and they're like Mr. and Mrs. Payne, you know, it's like one of the fanciest meals I've ever had in my life. But they brought us the tab and like we had gotten a bottle of wine. We had this 7-course meal. Like, I mean, it's my honeymoon.
Yeah,
we're like, we're balling out one meal,
like
one of these meals. Yeah. Everything else, we was like, we're ballers on a budget. But like this one meal, we're like, we're going all out. And they brought the bill and it was $70.
No way.
Total.
That would have been like hundreds.
Oh.
Maybe 1,000.
I don't know. I have no idea. But like if you go to any normal restaurant these days, like we went to Beach Break the other morning and shared a breakfast and it was $35.
Yeah.
It was just like, it's nuts.
When
so.
I got you guys our burritos for 910, the staff, I think we bought like 10 burritos. It was $155.
Nuts.
That's crazy.
Burritos.
And 7-course meal.
Yeah, 7-course meal. $7. Highly recommend Bali. It was bananas. But I got to go to Thailand with my dad. That was a crazy trip. The food's amazing. Rode elephants. I flew to South Africa 2 days after I turned 18 and spent 6 weeks in South Africa during the World Cup.
Dang.
That was insane. I got to go to a quarterfinal match between Argentina and Germany. I backpacked through Europe with my best friend right after college. We spent 21 days in 11 different countries.
Wow.
That was pretty nuts.
You met some weird people like in hostels.
Weirdest people. Yeah. We're staying in like the hostels where there's like 25 beds in a room.
Yeah.
And we literally had no money, like none. Yeah. So we bought our flights there. We knew we were flying in and out of London. And then we bought Eurorail passes. So like $500 for a train ticket that can get you anywhere, basically.
Wow.
And then we had just like pennies left over. So we ate bread and tangerines. That's all we ate for like 3 weeks.
Yeah.
I remember we were so hungry. We were in I think we were in Belgium, and we broke down one night and we went to Pizza Hut.
Which
is just like the most non-cultured thing ever, but we were both just starving.
I thought you were going to say like we went and got Belgian waffles.
No, we did do that one morning. We did do that one morning, but we went to Pizza Hut. We got a meat lover's pizza. We just scarfed it down because we were so hungry. But yeah, that was a crazy trip. I didn't have enough money to fly home.
Oh.
We were in Berlin trying to get back to London because our flights from London were coming back home, and we neither one of us had enough money to check our bag.
Oh my gosh.
We were trying to carry it on and they wouldn't let us because it was too big. And so there was $25 to check the bag and neither one of us had $25.
What did you do? Did you just get rid of it?
He got a hold of his dad somehow dad like direct transferred $50 into our Chase account.
Oh my gosh.
Literally didn't have $25.
How'd you even buy the plane ticket?
Ryanair. It's cheap. I spent my last like $30. It was like $30 to fly from Berlin to London.
That's crazy.
On Ryanair. But anyways.
Good memories though.
Great memories. Worst trip. This is bad. These people are probably never going to listen to this, but I bought a ticket with an old girlfriend.
Oof.
To Nashville to go see Macklemore at the Grand Ole Opry.
Okay.
So random.
Yeah.
And poor girl, I was such a jerk. In Nashville, I realized that like this isn't gonna work out. Oof. And so I was just like a weird weekend.
So you had to pretend, like, did you tell her like, hey, this isn't gonna work out? And then you continued the trip?
No, I think we broke up when I got home.
Okay.
But it was just bad. It was like one of my best friends and his now wife, and then like me and this girl, like the four of us went over.
Okay, the girl is separate. She's not in the picture. Okay.
No, she's not
friends anymore.
She's
I'm sure literally she's great. The best. She's totally
literally
great.
The best. I was a jerk. Let's just make that clear.
That's right. But
yeah, that was bad. That was a bad trip.
Yeah.
That was a long answer to a very short question.
No, I'm here for the long answers always.
Yeah. What's have you been out of the, you've been to Israel?
I've been to Israel. I've been to China.
Whoa.
Yeah. Have you been to China?
No. I've been to Beijing. I've been to Hong Kong.
Okay.
I was in Hong Kong for like 2 days, but it doesn't really count.
I feel like that kind of counts.
It was a layover.
Oh.
But it was like an overnight.
Okay.
Like
so
we flew in the morning. We were there all day, spent the night. Yeah. We were there the whole next day and then flew out.
Yeah. But. Yeah. So I've been to China, been to Israel and Ecuador. With one of those was with you.
Ecuador.
Yeah.
That's what's up. How was the Chinese food? I've heard it's not great.
Yeah, so
like our version of Chinese food is not their version of Chinese food.
No, not at all. I was young. I was only 14 turning 15 and I went without my family.
Mm.
So I was just like kind of exposed to all of this type of Chinese food.
And wait, who'd you go with?
I actually went, so my best friend in high school, she lived in China for 8 years.
Whoa.
And her dad still lived there. Her parents were divorced. And she's like, I'm going back home to visit my dad. Do you want to come? And I was like, absolutely yes. So went with her for 3.5 weeks the summer in between my freshman and sophomore year of
high
school.
That's a long time.
Yeah, I got back from that trip the next day, left for summer camp with 9-10 when I was
Whoa.
In 9-10.
Was that Lake San Antonio?
Don Pedro?
Don Pedro.
Breakout?
I knew it was
Shout
one
out.
Of those.
Yeah.
One of those, you know, Don Pedro, San Antonio.
All the same. Basically just look like dry mountains and then there's just a lake. It's not really that pretty, but.
The dream. The dream. Living the dream.
That was a crazy camp. Anyways, the food, I don't want to sound like, you know, rude, but the food was pretty rough. I wasn't vegetarian back then. Now I'm vegetarian. So I didn't have an excuse.
It was mid, as the kids say.
I would say it was worse than mid.
Oh, worse than mid. Ooh. Yikes.
But I didn't
What's
have
worse
an excuse?
Than mid? What would people say? Bunk?
Oh, I've never heard that. Yeah, it was rough. I had to eat the meat because I didn't have an excuse. Mm. And I remember this one meal, we got invited to this wedding and never met the bride and groom, but because, I mean, this is just the reality of the culture, but because we were white, we got to sit at table one.
Oh, weird.
I know. Super
so weird.
And it was like a 7-course meal.
Mm.
And there
Shout
one
out
of the
to Bridges.
Courses, there was this entire fish, like eyes, teeth, just like on the table.
Did you get that in Ecuador at all?
No.
Really?
Well, Ecuador, I was vegetarian.
So
I had an excuse.
Bus.
Yeah.
Bunk.
But yeah, the food was pretty rough. I ate a lot of like American food, European food when I was there because I couldn't. It was really hard for me.
Yeah. My brother went on like a study tour when he was at Biola and he said all the food was like so salty.
Mm-hmm.
And then they would give you like this much to drink.
Yes.
And so he'd be like savoring this tiny bit to drink.
A tiny little cup before your food comes.
Yeah.
And it has to last you the pre-meal, during meal, and post-meal.
Crazy. I wonder where we got our idea of Chinese food.
I don't know.
Panda Express is not Chinese food.
No. But I mean, there's like fried rice in China. Like fried rice is a big deal. But it's a lot
Orange chicken, though?
No. Not so
Beef
much.
And broccoli, though? Chow mein?
Yeah.
I love Chinese food.
It's like,
I'm low-key craving Chinese food now.
Okay, I just tried the Impossible Orange Chicken, which is like vegetarian. It was incredible.
Okay.
But like that's like burritos, right? Like burritos aren't actually Mexican.
Not
authentic
at all.
Mexican food.
Not at all.
Where did we get that? But they're delicious.
Delicious. I will argue all day long that San Diego has the best Mexican food in the world. Not Mexico.
Whoa.
Hot take. Hot take. All right, Katie, any more questions in there?
I have a couple.
Okay. Let's rip them off real quick, and then we're going to get into 1 Kings 17.
One, I hope these aren't, I don't know if those are too long, but if you could say anything to 21-year-old Austin, what would you say? And then your biggest ministry fail, and that can be an event, that can be a situation that you handled poorly, that could be, that question's up to your interpretation.
Dang. 21-year-old self. I think the same thing I would, my 40-year-old self is probably going to tell my 30-year-old self is what I would tell my 21. I think it's just relax. Mm. Like just calm down.
Yeah.
Like you're going to be okay.
Yeah.
I think at 21, I was lost. First of all, I didn't know which way was up at 21. The 21-year-olds that I work with for the most part are in a much better place than I was at 21. Mm. Like 18 to 22 for me were like, massively exploration, lots of failure, testing limits. Like I was the stereotypical, like touch the stove, 18 to 20, just like partying, smoking weed, doing dumb things.
Yeah.
But I think I was just trying to explore my limits.
Mm.
And I was like, at first it was like, this is so fun. Like I lived the life of like, to be a Christian is boring, but you get heaven at the end.
Yeah.
And I was tired of being bored.
Yeah.
But I wasn't bored anymore. I had a ton of fun, but I was lonely and it just wasn't real. It's just like, I think I heard my whole life, the church and Christianity is the only place that like can actually fill you up.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's like the world can't fill you up. And now I would look at that and just be like, that's just not true. Like the world can absolutely fill you up.
Yeah.
Like it's fun.
Sin is fun. Yeah.
It's like
enticing.
Satisfying.
Yeah.
It's so awesome. The only problem is you're full and then you're empty and then you're full and then you're empty and then you're full. And it's like, you're constantly chasing what's the next thing that's going to fill me up.
Yeah.
Whereas I think like when Jesus talks about living water, he's talking about something that's like sustainable, you know, like I think about, I don't know where it is. Isaiah, Jeremiah talks about like the, you've built yourself these taverns that are cracked, like these cisterns that are cracked. And when you think about that, like right in Israel, we went underground and we stood in the cisterns.
Yeah.
And when the cisterns were cracked, they would fill them with water and then the water would just seep back into the earth.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the picture to me of like my life. It was like, I was getting full and I was having fun. I was playing soccer and had, you know, friends and all this stuff, but it seemed like I was like, I'd be full and then it would just like empty.
Dang.
And then I would just have to chase the next thing. And I think, a big part of that, like relax word is like the more I lean into a relationship with Jesus, the less life is like this.
Yeah.
And it's a little bit more like stable and consistent, which I think we all crave at the end of the day. Like the irony is like in my life, the times where I was living out of a duffel bag and like continent hopping and like doing all this stuff is like, it was so fun, but I craved consistency.
Mm.
You know, I craved a church. Mm. I craved like community. The thing that I always wanted was a Tuesday night softball league.
Mm, like you can only be involved in that if you're like consistent.
Right. That's all I want. But I was like, I just want a Tuesday night softball league. That's all I wanted. Have I played softball since? No. But one time Paige and I were in a softball league together. That's a whole other story. But
I need to
she
hear
struck
story.
Out in slow pitch softball and we were dating and I was like humiliated. Like,
oh my gosh.
Young, not confident Austin. Our relationship was so rocky.
That's probably really good for you.
I was like, babe, you just struck out in slow pitch softball. I was so, and she was
oh
like, la da 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 da. Like Paige, not a worry of the world. Like doesn't care
Paige.
At all. My identity is like caught up in being an athlete. And I'm like, you must get a hit. Right.
Yeah.
Like who the frick cares?
Yeah.
But funny story. story. But that's what I craved. But now, yeah, like most of the time when you're in consistency, you're like, oh, I just want to travel. Right. Like, I just want to go. I want to. It's like to anybody that's like just wants to travel, it's like, go travel for 6 months
and you'll, yeah,
it's awesome.
Yeah.
But
yeah,
I think that's just the human condition. Mm. It's like you want what you don't have. And then when you have that, you'll want what you had.
Yep.
It's just normal.
Yeah. Oof, that was good.
Ministry fail. My first job in ministry was kind of a nightmare. Mm. I did a year and a half at a church up on the Central Coast, and I wouldn't call it a failure, but that's, I just don't, like, my dad says this all the time, and I totally agree. He's like, I just don't really do regret. Like, that's not how I live my life. I don't look back and, like, massively regret things. I feel like I tend to fail and learn a lot from that failure.
Like, own it. Yeah.
And then I don't, there's not a lot that I look back on, and I've made 1,000 mistakes. Mm. But I don't look back on them and I'm like, dang, I massively regret those things. I'm like, I'm not sure I would be who I am today without those things. Yeah. And so, yeah, that first year and a half, though, probably like the biggest lesson I took away was in my exit interview. One of the pastors who's now the senior pastor there, he looked at me and he's like, Austin, don't get me wrong. Like, the last year and a half has been gnarly.
Yeah.
Like, the church staff had 30 people on it. We lost 11 full-time staff in a year and a half.
Whoa.
Like, it was, there was infidelity involved. There's just a lot going on,
yeah,
but he was like, you had 80% freedom over your world. Like, I was the junior high pastor up there. Mm. He's like, but you couldn't stop looking at the
20%.
Oof. And that like rocked me.
Yeah.
And I think that was like a big failure of mine at the time, was I was so obsessed with the 20%, you know?
Mm.
And I think that's just going to be real. Like,
yeah,
at North Coast, I probably have like 85% freedom. But there's things like, just within any job, any organization,
yeah,
any church, there's going to be things that you're like, I probably wouldn't do it that way, or that's kind of frustrating, or
yeah,
fill in the blank.
Yeah.
But if you just focus on those things, you'll drive yourself crazy.
Yeah.
And so I think for me now, like, so much of my focus, so much of my time is like, how do I focus on the 85%?
Yeah.
And lean into that and let the 15% be the 15%, right? Like,
that's so good.
You kind of get comfortable with being uncomfortable.
Yeah.
It's just real. That's just life. So,
and then you can learn from, like, okay, I wouldn't do it this way. But then to see someone be successful in the way that they do something, it's like, oh, okay, humble myself to realize that the way that it's going is working.
Mm.
And maybe I'll learn something from that too.
Totally.
Yeah, but that's good.
Totally. Speaking of humble myself, we were talking about this before we started podcasting here, but in First Kings, I love that at our summer camp this last year, Brian Howard taught through this passage, and he talked about, he said, the most arrogant response that we can have as humans is, I got this.
Yeah.
Right. Which kind of ties into like my 20-year-old self or my 30-year-old self. Like, how often are we, I got this, people? And Braden taught on this passage in First Kings chapter 17, where Elijah and the widow have this interaction after Elijah, the brook dries up, and he's kind of forced out of comfort into like, all right, God, would you provide me direction? Would you give me this? I'm forced to be dependable on you, Lord, or dependent on you, Lord. And the three questions that came out of this passage were, God, will you, or from God, will you trust me? Will you lean on me? Will you be with me? And Elijah really forced to answer those questions.
Mm-hmm.
And I love that definition, right? The humility is like this willingness to ask for help. Humility is this willingness to be dependent. Where have you seen that flesh out, like, it in this story, but like even personally in your life, like as a 21-year-old?
Yeah.
There's a lot of life where you're kind of, you almost like feel like you need to be like, I got this.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
It's like that fake it till you make it mentality. I got this.
Yeah.
And humility is really the willingness to just kind of go like,
I don't got this. Yeah.
But even that, there's like a balance to that.
Totally.
You can't just walk around like, I don't got this.
Totally.
Because it's like, you gotta live your life.
Yeah.
And you gotta lead and you gotta do ministry. And what do you see the balance there?
Well, first, I think that's like a huge pitfall for working in ministry. Because it's like, okay, I'm having students, especially in student ministry, I'm having students look to me. Like, there is this level of like, I need to have composure. Like, I kind of need to have a little bit of it.
Right.
You know, I got it figured out. But at the same time, without the Holy Spirit, I have nothing. And I like having the humility to be like, I can't do this on my own. And sometimes I'm going to fail students or fail my leaders or just not do a good job. And knowing that I'm not like above that. But I think that tension is like, I was talking about this actually in a life group a couple weeks ago about how I feel like the Lord is so faithful to bring me back to a place of depletion or, oh my gosh, I'm so exhausted or so burnt. I have nothing. And then it's like, thank you, Lord, for bringing me back to this place, because that's where you show up. Like, that's where you show me that it was never on my own strength anyways. It was always you moving. But I think, yeah, I run really hard and then think that I have it or think that I can do a good job and then come to a place where I failed someone or did something wrong or don't have the answer or I'm really tired and exhausted. And then the Lord is gracious to like walk me through that too. So I think, yeah, having the humility to ask for help when you need it, or, but kind of, okay, this is maybe a weird parallel, but have you ever heard like work from a place of rest, not working for rest?
Yeah,
like working
totally.
From a place of like, I know that I can't. So that changes how I do and how I work and how I live my life instead of like continuously getting to a place where it's like, oh no, I have nothing, which I think is like my tendency. Like I tend to run hard and then get to a place where I'm like, oh,
okay, I need to rest now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I think humility and rest kind of go hand in hand in that way of to recognize like, no, I can't, I need rest. And so I'm going to be humble enough to know that I'm not the only one who can get it done. Like this work will continue without me. Like God will move without me. But then also have the like tension of, but he's equipped me and I have gifts and like, I'm going to use them well. So it's hard. That tension is hard.
Right. Yeah. It seems like I feel like I say this a lot, but it seems like that's one of those tensions to manage rather than a problem to solve.
Yeah.
You know, you just go like that. That's just going to be the reality of figuring out that balance and then like failing and falling flat on your face and then going like, okay, all right, that wasn't it.
Yeah.
And then continuing to take steps forward. I totally relate to that. God bringing us back to places where we're dependent on him and like the gift that can be. Mm. I've never been somebody that struggled with anxiety or that being something that's been like a part of my life, which I'm like extremely grateful for.
Yeah.
Like that's such a gift. But I will always remember like, there was this like 2 or 3 week period, 2021 coming out of COVID where we had just opened up in-person stuff again.
Yeah.
And we were down on the edge. There was like this like 2-3 week period where I was like, there was so much ambiguity on like, what are we aiming at?
Yeah.
And for me, like that's one of the biggest like stressors in my life is like when things are ambiguous. Like right now, like Paige's due date was yesterday. And I'm like my whole life is ambiguous right now. It's like, people are like, hey, can you meet this week? I'm like, maybe.
Yeah.
Like I would love to. No, even this morning, it's like, am I going to be in the office? Am I not going to be in the office?
Right.
Are we going to film this podcast? Am I not going to film this podcast? Yeah. Like, and in the middle of that ambiguity, like I don't do super well.
Yeah.
And I like a lot of that's like, I want to be in control and I want to know what I'm aiming at. And like, I'm pretty good at being like flexible and adaptable if I know like the direction that I'm headed,
yeah.
You know, ultimately I think with the ambiguity is a killer for me. And that was like the theme word coming out of COVID was like, everything is ambiguous.
Yeah.
And there was like this 2 week period where I like wrestled with anxiety and it's forced an empathy on me that I don't think I ever had before with anxiety.
Awesome.
I think it was always kind of like, get over it, you know, white knuckle, pull your boots up. And, but there was one particular Wednesday night fuel where I was about to get on stage and I felt like an elephant was standing on my chest and I was just like, I need to get out of this room right now. And I walked out of the edge and I just walked across the plaza and my heart was racing. And I was like praying before I went on stage, like, Lord, I need you so bad right now.
Yeah.
Cause like, I cannot teach this message. I can't lead this night. Like I can't do this. Like I just wanted to like run.
Yeah.
And I think that little, you know, when you think a thought that's too smart for you to think, it's probably God. it was one of those just like, slap across the face in a loving way of like, oh, now you need me?
Oof.
And I'm like, every other Wednesday night, like, I got this. Right?
But,
which is just the, like, that's the worst place to do ministry from and operate in life from, right? It's like God asking, will you trust me? Will you lean on me? Will you be with me? The most arrogant thing we can say, I got this.
Mm-hmm.
And God constantly, like, in his grace and his kindness, bringing us back to a place of like, let me demonstrate to you.
Yeah.
Who you are and who I am, right? Like it's that Job 38, like, where were you?
Yeah, when I created
you know,
that,
like,
ooh, that's, yeah.
I think that's his kindness. And yet most of the time we look at that like, oh, God, like why'd the brook dry up?
Yeah.
Why am I out of oil? Why am I out of flour? Why'd my son die, right? Like that, so gnarly. Those things like are real.
Yeah.
Like I'm gonna lay down and die. Yeah. That's what she says. and God just bringing us back to that place, like a lot of times in his kindness.
Yeah.
Like, let me demonstrate to you what life is actually about. Yeah.
Right. And he's so faithful. He's so faithful then, even in the middle of the, I got this, to still like give us grace and mercy in that. But then also, I just heard a quote recently that was, don't be too arrogant to think that God can't work through your failure. Mm. So even when I'm in the space of, I got this, God is still moving through my brokenness there, which is like, praise God that I don't get in the way of, even when I am in the way, like he's still going to move.
Yeah.
Like he's not going to be.
Yeah.
I don't know. That's good.
It's good. All right. We got to finish the same way we always finish.
Dating advice.
Dating advice. In 30 seconds or less, as a single gal who's 21.
Yeah.
You're much more relatable to our listeners than I am.
Yeah.
What, if you just like were forced one-on-one in a conversation, what's the one thing I need to know about dating? What would you say?
Oh, well, I have something, but I don't know if it's like the one thing.
Okay, it doesn't have to be the one thing. I won't make that intense.
Okay, yeah. I feel like you put me in a box.
I'm sorry.
For a little bit. No, okay. I was having a conversation with someone yesterday, with a friend, and I think this relates to friendships, not just dating.
Mm.
But I think that it relates to fighting. So like disagreements, issues within dating or with friendships.
Okay.
I think there is a space.
Oh, maybe we shift. Maybe this is the beginning
of
a new ending to the 910 podcast where we talk about friendship advice. Because there's a lot there.
Yeah.
All right. We're putting dating to death. We're killing dating right now.
That's a big shift.
We're kissing dating goodbye.
That's a little bit rough.
It's an Easter egg.
Anyways. Okay. Yeah. I think that there is a space from the moment that you have an argument or a disagreement or you're hurt, and then a space, and then the conversation that resolves that issue. And that space could be, I think that there is this, there's a space for you to show up authentically and love that person, knowing that you're hurt or you're in pain or there's a disagreement, and you're not allowing that to impact your relationship in a moment. So like flush that out. That looks like maybe you're with a friend or with your significant other in a public space and they say something that totally digs at you, or they do something that's painful or they hurt or push one of your buttons. I think you can show up authentically, love them through that space. You're not going to be like, hey, let's go step outside, but you're engaged with them. You're still with friends. You're still loving on them, even though you're hurt. You're holding this piece of like, that really hurt, and we're going to need to have a conversation about that.
Mm.
And I think sometimes when I talk to people about that, their response is, well, that's inauthentic to not like share my emotions with them or like have that conversation. And then my response is it really inauthentic to not be like controlled by your emotions? Like, can you not? Do you have to respond because you're so emotionally charged in this moment?
Yeah, that's good.
Which then is probably not going to lead to a great conversation anyways, because you're like so angry, so frustrated.
Hmm.
And so like healthy conflict. Okay, let's take a moment. I'm going to step away. I'm going to have this conversation. I know it will happen. Like eventually we're going to get there.
Hmm.
But I can like hold this tension of like being in a public space, or
that's fire.
Maybe you're separated and they're like going hang out with friends. Don't ruin their night. Like know that, okay, conversation's going to come, but let them go be with their guys or be with their gals or whatever.
Mm.
And then know that like, we'll have this conversation because, okay, sorry. I know this is long.
You have the conversation.
Yeah. Well,
I'm saying like there needs to be a conversation that resolves it.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
You know what I mean? But
yeah.
Which is a whole other.
Yeah. Wisdom and discernment in that too. Yeah. But I think too, like that's a little bit selfish to be like, we have to have this conversation right now.
Right.
At their expense.
Yeah.
So healthy conflict.
It's good. That's really good. I needed to hear that. That's good. It's good advice. It's good wisdom.
Thanks.
Did Paige tell you to say that?
No.
Paige. Oof. Calling Paige right now.
I love Paige.
I'm not very good at that.
Mm.
I'm like very authentic. Like I want to have this conversation, and Paige will be like, we don't need to do this right now. Like that's something we've had to work through. Cause I wholeheartedly agree with you. Mm. I'm just not very good at that.
Yeah.
I'm not very good at being in a space when I'm not good with people.
Yeah.
Like I want to get to the bottom of that, but you're totally right. Like it's not inauthentic. It's just immature.
Ooh.
Right.
Yeah.
Like Piper, when she feels something,
lets it out,
feels it in its entirety.
Yeah.
Right, like at 30 years old, we should be able to feel something and go like, it's okay to have a conversation about this later.
Yeah.
And not be like, let the emotion be driving our life. That's good.
Yeah.
That's really good. KDB.
Thanks.
Spitting heat. All right, 910, that was your first official friendship advice.
I'm here for the change.
Let's go. All right, peace out, Cub Scouts.
Bye.